Chapter 1. The ship. Lightning struck the surface. Pressurized air reported out over the Atlantic. Rain lashed at his face. The boat took on water. Turning back, he couldn't see the lights along the shore. He pulled on the tiller, the 13-footer lurched, and he ducked as the boom swung overhead. A microburst of wind and a wave conspired. The craft flipped and he was tossed into the sea. Salt water filled his lungs. He panicked and kicked. He coughed up fluid. He utilized forceful strokes over to the boat now lying on its side, the sail lapping the seascape. The boat turned in the water as the mast became fully submerged. The keel dagger stood up against the sky. He had no choice but to stay with it. Scrambling onto the upside-down hull, fighting against buckets of sheeted rain, Eli wrapped his arms around the daggerboard. He had heard of a way to flip a day sailor like this from an upside-down position, but he had never done it. He stood up, grabbed the keel, leaned back and shifted his weight, rocking, slowly back and forth, gaining momentum. It was just about upright when suddenly another bigger wave crashed all over him. He slipped and hit his head on the plastic as he fell over backwards headfirst into the ocean. Stunned, he still had a chance. Onto the upside-down hull, his muscles burning, once more he grappled and pulled. He saw the red droplets gathering onto the white fiberglass just beneath his head. Eli held on against the thrashing wind and the storm surrounded him. He watched his yellow safety preserver float off, dragged away from beneath the surface by an unknown deity. Why hadn't I worn it? After some time, the rain slackened, and he felt cloud vapor creeping and permeating his mind. His blood sugar levels dropped. He shivered. He thought. He was 17 years old. It was June 15th, the first day of summer vacation. He was surprised at having enjoyed the final semester. He had one more year to go, then he would move out onto his own. He hated being a foster child. He hadn't mentioned to anyone that he would be taking the boat out. He had been almost secretive. For no reason. How long have I been gone? He thought about the recent local news reports of shark sightings. Two great whites had been seen only miles from his current location off the coast of Montauk. There weren't other obvious options than to just lay and wait with whatever might be out there. He thought about school. Eli had talked with his teacher, Mr. Heller, after class to discuss the final paper. It was the last day and everyone had scattered at the bell. So, Mr. Elderbrook, you ask now. The school's philosophy teacher prompted him, sensing something breaking within. I had read a novel for English class and included an analysis in my final paper, along with what we covered here, Eli explained. The Brothers Karamazov, Eli blurted. I know the book, his teacher spoke. Could you relate to one of the brothers? Heller asked, fishing for where the conversation might be going. Smodukov was the outsider. Eli was baring his soul, hoping Heller understood, probably because he was the philosophy professor. It was more of an understanding of the dynamic between all the brothers. The different personality types, Eli explained to the professor. Who were your parents? Mr. Heller asked. I only have very distant visions and memories of them. I don't really know who they were, Eli said. You must find out, so you know who you are. You should investigate, and then when you come back in the fall after discovering self, putting myself in your shoes, I would see no harm in the knowing. It is strange to talk about them, I remember so very little. They died in a plane crash in Paraguay. My mother was a writer and my father worked at a university. That's all I know. I have vague far-off memories of them and ideas. I don't know how much of it is reality or just in my mind. I will tell you, from my perspective, there would be a police report. From there, you can begin to find out who you are. For extra credit, you must write a journal in preparation for next year's class. Just a little essay, personal notes every day, like an army dispatch. You can just dash things off as you encounter them. I can up the paper a notch if you promise to follow through for me on that, his teacher proposed. Ali's mind opened to new possibilities. Something clicked, but he didn't fully understand, thinking about them like that. Good. You are going through an identity crisis. You must fill the empty space with knowledge and information about your natural family. You are at the beginning of a journey and I want your journal to reflect this. Be more like Alexei and less like Smodukov, he explained. Eli had put the whole conversation out of his mind, until now out of sight. Paraguay. All options led to the unknown. He couldn't make a move in any direction. The wind eventually calmed. He just rolled with the waves. The fog was thick. He heard the deep rumbling of a ship's horn miles away. Losing consciousness. Far away, people lived out the circumstances of their existence as extensions and reflections of their environment. A girl with long black hair appeared close to him. He couldn't see her face. They traveled into the desert on foot. Men were taking him to the place where his father had died. In the wide expanse of the desert rolling badlands, wary of tigers that had recently escaped from the zoo and packs of previously domesticated dogs now returned to the wild. Eli woke up suddenly, startled by the large presence of something approaching his personal space. A white freighter ship pulled up alongside him. The fog broke apart in varied directions. There was an insane loud blast from the ship. He heard the voices of men up on the deck, but he didn't understand the language. He heard a clanking sound, then a chain metal ladder was lowered. He stood up, still holding onto the keel dagger. Heads of men appeared over the rail. He wondered how long he had been asleep. His forehead pounded as he reached out for the ladder and he pulled himself up. After climbing some, they yanked him to the top deck with quick strokes. Whoosh, he was on board, face to face with two aged men. They each sported black hair to the shoulders, and they had curious eyes. The men stared back at him with slightly broken teeth that appeared with a grin. Eli smiled back and the men made chortling and chuckling sounds. They inspected his forehead with the fingers. Eli looked about, his wits returning, feeling a sense of relief. Life's tensions were evaporating, the fog now in retreat. "Follow me," a third man said, speaking a weird, broken English. One of the men lifted a hatch on the deck, revealing a ladder. The third man led him down and through to a metal passageway. Everything was painted red. He was dizzy but hanging on. There were pipes, tubing, and valves creating a ceiling matrix. This is what the inside of a military ship must look like. Eli would have been impressed with any moderately sized ocean-going vessel. The third man opened a thick steel door mounted to chunky, well-oiled hinges. He motioned for Eli to follow. Inside the medical room, the man unlocked a cabinet and took out a bottle filled with pills, putting two of them on the steel table. He produced a mason jar filled with water. For pain, the man spoke English with the unusual accent. Eli swallowed the pills and gulped down the liquid. Liquid had never tasted so absorbent. Within moments he began to feel warm. He didn't worry what the drugs were, he was safe, alive. The man seated him down opposite shiny metal cabinets. He saw the reflection of his own face staring off at an obscure angle. Somehow, he looked different, like someone else. He watched as the man cleaned the gash on his head with iodine and cotton swabbing. Mesmerized by his reflection, from the odd perspective, it looked as if the man were putting his fingers inside of his head. There was a patience about his movements, a delivery and other subtle, specific, professional qualities. He was confident. Eli wasn't sure if he was actually a doctor. The man finished sewing, wrapped Ali's head with gauze and secured bandage with white tape. He left Eli alone in the room. He was woozy. Everything felt spongy. The man returned after a moment with some dry clothes. Standing up, Eli almost toppled over. His head was cloudy, but he got himself together. The man led him, stumbling, down a metal corridor, around corners and finally to a cabin with a bed. He fell into the mattress and was sleeping within moments. That night, he experienced another remarkable dream. He was in a garden in the sunshine with fluttering multicolored butterflies everywhere around him. He could smell the plants and flowers. One butterfly began speaking to him with a feminine voice. By her tone, Eli knew he could trust her with his soul. She morphed into a beautiful woman right in front of him. "I have come to convey a warning," she exclaimed. "Your fate is still to be decided by the gods. Your decisions will have consequences for the future." Eli felt more alive in her presence, as if she exuded a universal life force. Her blonde curly hair fell about her body. Her posture made her look as if she had wings. "There is someone you must find," she demanded of him, staring at Eli, her eyes piercing into his soul. He was comforted by her presence but alarmed by her stare. She knew him in a way no one ever had known him. Her eyes were implicitly expressing warning. "There are times for life and death. There is a knowledge that you must begin to understand." She flew off into nothingness. Eli woke up as light poured through a small round hole onto his face. He couldn't remember anything at first, then it all flashed back. He was on a Chinese freighter out in the Atlantic. His head was pulsing, sewn up and bandaged. Springing off the bed, he looked out the porthole. The sunshine was blinding. He looked around, taking stock of the cabin. There was an open door leading to a simple bath setup, a desk with a number 2 pencil and blank sheets of 20-hash regular size paper, a second single bed made up with designed orange top sheets. Everything that could possibly move was bolted to the floor. On the nightstand sat a plate of donuts. Grabbing a glazed one, he casually made his way out into the red corridor, walking until he came upon a ladder, climbing up through the hatch and eventually hopping out onto the top deck. The deck area was massive. The ship created its own scale. It might have been small for a cargo freighter. Eli wasn't knowledgeable about those things. He was awestruck by the expanse of blue, spread out in every direction. The sky was a bigger full circle than he had ever seen. Sunlight reflected off the ocean onto his body. It was the brightest day he had ever experienced. He needed to speak with the captain or whomever was in charge, yet he enjoyed the stroll about the concourse of the white structure. Unencumbered by circumstances, he looked over the side and held onto the railing. He could see and feel the smashing as the ship cut its path, ceaselessly lurching the mass forward. He made it over to the tower-like structure towards the rear. He thought the captain must be up there behind the tall, dark slanted windows, steering the bulking vessel. He found a door behind a stack of metal containers and walked into the lower section of the tower. In the center of the room, there sat a large conference table covered with maps, coffee cups and ashtrays were strewn about. Five men, including the three from the night before, were seated around the table, engaged in discussions that Eli couldn't comprehend but by the gestures. They faced him with expressions, quickly giving over to friendly smiles. There was an awkward moment as he returned the look. It didn't last long. Both long-haired men got up from the table and leaned over to Eli. They held out their hands for a clasp among souls. The stares were focused on his forehead for a moment and then shifted reassuringly back to his eyes. Eli shook hands with both men at the same time. "Thank you," he repeated, hoping they understood, which of course they did. Obviously, being the captains, the confident mannerisms made Eli at ease. Eli looked up to the flat-screen TV hanging from chains, gently swinging with the ship's movements. He couldn't believe it. They were broadcasting a younger picture of him on NBC Channel 4 out of New York. The caption read, "Lost at sea, Eli Elderbrook presumed dead, search called off after 36 hours. Dead," the third man yelled out. Eli hadn't time to consider the events. Could I have been asleep for a day and a half? His foster parents, the Elderbrooks, appeared on the screen standing next to a Coast Guard officer. They were speaking and appeared to be crying. The faces held drawn expressions, but there was no sound coming from the speaker. Eli looked around the room. In a second, the third man was pointing the remote at the TV. Quote dot. "Although he wasn't our biological son, we are utterly devastated that he has drowned. We decided, this morning, to take on a new foster child in his memory." The officer stepped up to the newswoman. "It is of the utmost importance not to jump to conclusions. Anything could have happened out there. We found the boat, capsized. After pulling it out of the water, we retrieved personal items, including his report card and his driver's license, all inside a waterproof bag. We found a life preserver on the surface 2 miles away from the craft's location. I'm afraid, after a comprehensive 24-hour helicopter search of the entire Long Island coastal area, that Eli Elderbrook has not been found. That's all the information we have right now, folks." Miss Elderbrook had curly gold hair and tears running down her red cheeks as the reporter pointed the microphone in her face, though obviously she had finished speaking. The five scruffy men seated around the table went silent. The third man mumbled a quick translation into Chinese, or whatever language it was. The men looked directly at Eli. He didn't know if they realized that it was him on TV. Not knowing his name, they wouldn't have a reason to think that it was him. He looked like a little kid in the picture. He started to feel emotions coming on, turning his face away and outside into the sunshine. "That was quick," he spoke softly. The Elderbrooks had never considered him to be the flesh and blood real son. He had been replaced in a matter of hours. "This is crazy, I am right here." He was confused about his circumstances because he had been asleep for longer than it had felt. He was exhilarated to be on the ship moving through time and space, alive. He peered out over the ocean. The cresting waves on the surface looked like a flustery flag. "Am I really going back to Long Island? Or, no one will miss me?" Ali's mind kicked through different scenarios. The ocean and the freshness of the wind on his face, the sunlight reflecting like a venturing glitter, rippled off and sparked his imagination. His future was unknown. He paced the length of the deck structure, thinking, then headed back to the conference room. The five men were there as he had left them. "Are we going to New York? Where are we going?" Eli almost shouted. The men nodded. The third man spoke up for the captains. "Back at New York in 3 days. We are stopping in Portland, then reloading up. We can drop you off in Portland and New York." "New York," Eli stated. "How is your head? Do you want to make a call? Food?" "I am fine, a little sore. Thank you for stitching me up. I will make a call later. I am happy to be alive." That day, he shared a celebratory lunch with the men. The food was set about in a festive manner, cured meats from Italy, frothy beer from Ireland, fresh baked bread from a New York establishment. After the meal, Eli accompanied the two captains up in the bridge. The view was a commanding 360-degree dome of sky with the sun falling behind the vast crimson Atlantic Ocean. The vessel wasn't new by any measure. It did host an array of modern industrial electronic components and surface interface pads for controls. Eli steered, briefly, at the helm. Most of the time navigation was controlled by the computers. When it got dark, the outline of Maine's coastline appeared lit up. One of the crew spoke, "Casco Bay is home to 300 islands. At 10 p.m. they docked at Portland. Ali's head throbbed, but he refused an offer for more pills, making his way back to the cabin. Seafood from a local restaurant was delivered to his room. He began writing a journal about his adventure. He wrote 5 pages in a heroic effort of his imagination. He had only recently been writing at all. He heard plenty of activity going on outside his window. He would just write down the events onto paper as they occurred, just a simple journal, like army dispatch entries. Eli was extremely grateful to have been saved by the men. They had shown him hospitality. Surprisingly, they didn't ask him a million questions, nor did they try to control him. He was treated with respect and he was comfortable. That's a first. He fell asleep around midnight pondering his new freedom. A plan was needed. He awoke during the night, hearing strange mechanical clanking and echoing from the bowels of the ship. He thought they were out at sea again. He had another dream. He was standing on the stone steps of the Supreme Court building in front of the white pilloried edifice. A black car pulled up right out in front. Miraculously, his father got out of the car. Eli followed him up to the entrance in awe. His father did not recognize him directly. Inside, the building was a large factory complex with masses of steel machinery. Eli wanted to talk to him, but his father was too busy describing the complexities of the facility to a group of important people. The cacophony being too much for Eli, he went outside alone. He sat on a park bench in the middle of a lightly tree, green and yellow field. An old professor sat next to him. The man told Eli about a European philosopher who had proposed the theory of deconstructivism. He spoke softly. The theory had some relevance to the analysis of comparative religion. The professor explained, thereby breaking down the cults into the pieces for the primordial linguistic characteristics and archetypes, allowing for a new creation of all the best parts from the old religions into a new synthesis. Eli awoke and quickly jotted down everything he could remember of the complexity of the dream. Without a clock, he felt that it was very early in the morning. He looked out the porthole. Sure enough, it was a different location from the Portland wharves. They weren't moving. He saw a tall, stoutly shaped dock. There were houses sprinkled in among the pine trees on the gently sloping shore around the cove. A blue lobster boat was pulling up alongside. Eli ventured topsides to take in the scene. A ramp had been lowered to the boat from the open side door on the ship's hull. A chain of men handed off boxes from one to another very quickly, until all the boxes had been transferred to the ship. The men retreated to the lobster boat. The ship's ramp was raised mechanically, clicking and clanking. Eli heard the deep rumbling of the diesel engines coming to life. The cargo freighter awkwardly made its way out of the tiny Chandler's Cove on the south side of Chavig Island, turning this way and that, struggling to remain in the channel. He made it up to the bridge. The crew chief, Chang, was explaining some history. President Roosevelt moored his yacht right here in 44, during the war. Back then, submarine nets were strung between the islands, protecting the harbor from Nazi U-boats. Casco Bay represents a dangerous cluster of islands for a large freighter. Within 20 minutes, avoiding minefields of ledge rock, they were out to the safety of the regular channels and onto deeper sea. The ocean was more turbulent. The ship swayed. Eli kept his balance, despite the movements being exaggerated, further off axis up in the bridge. The captains were concentrating their attention on the radar screens and through the tall glass panels onto the chaotic world outside. The computers were beeping and making digital sounds. One of the captains entered coordinate data into the GPS. There was a storm outlined in green at the top of the main radar display. The other captain had both hands firmly on the wheel as he consistently surveyed the dynamic waterscape. The waves rocked the boat. Eli got the feeling it wasn't time to hang around the bridge, so he headed back down. The third man greeted him at the bottom of the stairs. "There you are. Would you help us to stow the cargo?" "Yes." He was shown to the lobsters and the dozens of peculiar tanks. A crew member, dressed in red, demonstrated how to grab a creature out of one of the bins. He showed Eli how to put the rubber bands around the pinchers, and then, securing three at a time, they were tossed into the fish tanks. Eli got the hang of it after being bit once or twice, pesky suckers, but learning his lessons quickly, he made a peace with them. It was a workout. He had never worked so hard in his life. He made a project out of it. His hands became cold and sore. His back ached. His forehead throbbed. But his mind was clear. He had a good feeling when many hours later, the hundreds of sea beings were stored below, sealed in the glass tanks. He trudged with soggy sneakers back to the cabin. The five men treated him like an adult at dinner, in part, he thought, because he had put in so much effort at the work. They laughed, got drunk and spoke many languages. The two captains didn't drink as much as the others and were more silent, but they laughed in their original way, sharing a wisdom and a knowing confidence. Everyone ate huge lobster tails with buttery fingers and drank Russian vodka out of oversized crystal glasses. After dinner, Eli went straight off to bed. Before falling asleep, he thought about the few short days and how his life had changed. He didn't know what New York would bring, but he was toying with an idea. What would it be like to remain dead? I could get a job and live on my own. That was all he really wanted, just to be free and live his own life. He fell asleep satisfied with his day, thinking about things in the back of his mind. The next morning, he was up on the bridge helping the captains with navigation and the planning for the approach to Manhattan. A storm was approaching from the south. They plotted a course closer to Connecticut's coastline, inside the sound. After lunch, the third man pulled Eli's stitches and bandaged him up. he said, Scar, with that strange accent. His headache was just about gone. The rest of the afternoon he helped Cheng and the younger engineer, Felix, to scrub and wash down the upper decks. The next day off of New York City. He didn't have a plan yet, but his life would be different from this point forward. He already felt like a different person. As Eli coiled up the hoses, he saw a tall older man with shocking white hair, looking not like a sailor at all. The man exited the conference room and went quickly below. Eli skipped dinner and went to his cabin. On the way down, he wandered around the corridors. Two levels below, along an oddly lit blue hall, until he came upon a door that wasn't quite shut. He could hear a man speaking firmly, loudly, but with an articulated precision. He couldn't make out what the man was saying. Eli thought nothing of it and went back up to his room. He removed the bandage to see his head. In the mirror, he hardly recognized himself. He was shocked to see the diagonal cut, two black eyes and a bruised purple chin. He looked like Frankenstein's monster, aging in a few short days, but he had learned some things about himself. Realizing, seeing in his reflection, how close he had come to death. He was alarmed by the presence in the mirror, but all in all, he was happy, especially because he wasn't a foster kid anymore and he was determined to start his life over the very next day.